So how is everyone today?
Good.
Good? Okay. So while the document camera comes up to speed, are there any questions? Any questions? Yeah?
I mean, PGTW is kicking my butt, but...
Yeah? That's a hard one. Let's talk about it. It's, but I suspect that most of you, by the end of the semester, you'll get to a place of understanding and you'll think, I can't really understand what I thought was so difficult about the PGTW exercise.
Yeah.
I feel like I get the concept, I just don't know how to rationalize it in that way.
Okay. We'll get it going. I'm waiting for this to do something. Yes?
I had a question about the PGTW, but the 08 one.
Okay. I'm trying to get this thing to cooperate. Is this unplugged? Someone keeps doing that.
Cool.
That's what happened the first time, is that it was actually just barely unplugged. But now I know. Okay, so let's talk about the Pop Goes the Weasel exercise for just a minute. Okay, then we'll continue going over new things. Okay, so the Pop Goes the Weasel exercise, most of you probably have heard me say this, but in my head, what idea that I had is the childhood toy, you know, where you've got that box and it's got a crank on it, and you're turning the crank and you can hear it going do 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 do, and you keep turning the crank and then suddenly the box pops open, and you're not really sure, at least when you're a child, you're not very sure when it's going to happen, right? So the idea is, you know, abstracting that away, is that, you know, you have a device, and if you don't like the Pop Goes the Weasel thing, you can just think of it as a button, right? You've got a little machine, you press the button once, and then nothing happens. You press the button, you don't observe anything happen, but something inside of the machine is happening. Some process is occurring. You push the button again, nothing happens, again, nothing happens, and you push it over and over and over, and then something internal to the machine is happening that you can't observe, and then finally you push it one last time, and then you observe the machine explode or pop or whatever. Okay? So, I think everybody can understand the task. If I was to put a little device in front of you and I say, I want you to push the button on the device repeatedly until something happens, and push the button no more after this. I think that's perfectly comprehensible instruction. So the question is how do you tell a machine to do that? How do you tell MATLAB to do that? Okay. And it's a little bit, the problem I suspect, if you are having a difficulty with this exercise, the problem I suspect is that it's abstract. It's an abstract version of the Gauss problem to add up the integers. The Gauss problem is significantly less abstract because you can actually see the arithmetic occurring. Whereas with the Pop Goes the Weasel exercise, you don't see anything occurring. Something is happening inside, and it's hidden from your view. So what I want you to imagine is the following, is that we have, so this is the first consideration, we've got the device. And it's got its little crank arm on it. This is my artist's rendering of the side view of a Pop Goes the Weasel machine. Okay, and what I want you to do is turn the crank. So turn the crank once. Okay, so then let's say that inside the machine, inside the machine. I've initialized it outside of your view, and you cannot see inside of the machine. And I've initialized it to need exactly 3 cranks. So there's a 3 in there, but you can't see it. All that you can do is turn the crank. So if you turn the crank once, then now the machine, in the first place, you will observe that nothing happened. However, internal to the machine, something has happened. What has happened? Yeah, now it needs exactly 2 cranks. Okay, so that's what it needs now. And so now, because nothing occurred, that means I want you to do it again. So we'll turn the crank once. And again, you will observe that nothing happens. Nothing outward happens. But inwardly, what has happened in the internal state of the machine? Now it has a 1. Which means that now something interesting is going to occur, unbeknownst to us. So what will happen is we'll do this one more time. We'll turn the crank. And now the machine has a 0, which means that it needs no more cranks in it. So it's going to do something interesting. So out pops the weasel, I guess. This is my artist rendering of a weasel. Okay. So does everyone understand the conceptual bit? So here's the deal. In that exercise, I'm hiding some number. It's an arbitrary number, somewhat arbitrary. It's an integer between 5 and 100, which means that it's a random number. And I do it for 10 random numbers between 5 and 100. So on your, when your function's being tested, it might be 13, and then 73, and then 51, etc. So you have no idea. You can't see that green number inside of the machine. All I do is I hand it to you. Okay, and then you have to turn the crank exactly the correct number of times. Not less, not more, exactly the right number. Okay, so is there any question about the actual exercise? So now, in code, what is the actual command that turns the crank? Yeah, you give it a 2370, and if you don't like the abstract idea of turning the crank, you can think of pushing the button, right? Push the button. So what pushes the button? What turns the crank? It's you give that input argument, you call it as a function, and you give it 2370. Okay. So then, what all of these represents in code, there's got to be a line that says PGTW of 2370. That's what actually turns the crank. If you give PGTW a different number, it's going to say something like, no, I don't like that number. I don't like it. Okay, so here, that one is an invocation of PGTW of 2370. Here's another one. And here's another one. So the basic idea is that if I were to initialize the machine with, say, a 51 inside of it, you would have to call PGTW of 2370 exactly 51 times. That's what you must do. Okay? Now, the problem of it is that you don't know which one it's going to be. So if you knew it was going to be 51 times, then you could just write PGTW of 2370 and then copy and paste it 51 times. That's what I'm having you do in that other exercise. Except I don't say 51, I tell you it's 7. It's 7. Do it 77 times. Copy and paste 7 times. The problem on this exercise is you don't know what it's going to be. So, abstractly, the way it works is you need to make a function that does the following. It turns the crank exactly once. If the machine pops, then do nothing further. If the machine does not pop as a result of turning the crank that one time, then recurse back to yourself. And then what will happen is that you'll turn it once. If it was initialized with 51, you would turn it once and observe nothing, and the machine's internal state would now be 50, and recurse back to yourself. You turn it again, the machine's internal state will now be 49, nothing will happen, you recurse back to yourself, all the way down to the machine's internal state is 1, you turn the crank once, and the machine pops, you observe that, and you do nothing further. Okay, so sort of abstractly, is you need to make this a device that does the following. So this is the device. This is your function, crank.m. Okay, and what it does is it does the following. Is over here, in my secret laboratory, this is my Erlenmeyer flask. In my secret laboratory, I've initialized one of these machines, and I've put in a number, N. And it's hidden from you. You can't observe that N. And then I feed it to your machine. Your machine needs to do the following. It takes the device, it turns the crank once. So that's abstract, right? Turn the crank. What does that mean exactly, what I want you to do?
Call the function
once. I want you to call PGTW of 2370 exactly once. Me too. I want you to call it exactly once. Now, the thing is that PGTW is itself a function, which means it's going to return a value to you. Would someone please explain what the return value of this will be? Well, in this case, it'll probably be 0, but generally, what are the return values and what do they signify?
1 if it pops, 0 if it doesn't.
0 if nothing happened. If nothing visible happened, and 1 if the machine, popped like the child's toy. So you could, for example, say you could store the output of this in a variable. X is equal to that. X is equal to PGTW. So supposing that you do this. Now you have a value of X. Well, there's only two possibilities. One possibility is that the X that you found is equivalent to 0. Or no, let's say 1, because that's when we're not going to do anything else. So what does that mean? If the X that you found is 1. You popped. This means you do nothing further. The other possibility is what? What is the other possible value of X?
0.
X could be equivalent to 0. And in such a case, what are you supposed to do? Well, I agree we're going to need to do at least one more PGTW, but abstractly, you just take this and you put it back in the top of the machine. Because what this represents, it represents a machine that cranks the toy once, stops if it popped, and puts it back into itself if it didn't. Okay. So now, the name of this function, the name of this function is crank. Okay. So, in order to turn the crank once, you call PGTW of 2370, and you're going to store that in the variable x, or whatever variable you like. Doesn't have to be x. It could be q. Yeah. But how do you get back to the top? You have to recurse to yourself. Okay. So can someone tell us specifically what it is?
Crank.
Okay. So that's the function that has to be called.
And
no.
Oh,
PGTW. Because what's the name of the toy? The name of the toy is PGTW. So the toy, I initialized the toy back in my secret laboratory, and I put it in your machine the first time. Your machine will now turn the crank exactly once. If the machine pops, it'll stop. If the machine does not pop, it'll put the toy back in the top of the machine. So you'll call PGTW. This initial call is done by me. So I make a PGTW. I make one. And then I call your function. I put it into the machine. And now your machine's going to do this over and over and over and over and over 51 times until pop. Any question about this? Yeah?
Would the crank function, would that be different? How would that be different from the crank in function? Like where you have to do it in times? Right, this will also do it in times.
The difference is, it will do it in times. But the difference is, let's draw it. So is everybody okay with this? The difference is, they're actually quite similar. But now, if I'm going to do it this way, then I need to make it like this. This number and all of these numbers are invisible to you. You can't see those numbers. So literally what's happening is that you could look at the source code for the PGTW function. I'm keeping track of that number, and you don't have access to it. So now, here's a different exercise. So just like you could imagine that this one is, I'm telling you, just keep pushing the button until the thing does something interesting. Just push it, push it, push it, push it, push it. Okay, now I could put a new device in front of you. And not only is there a button, but there's a display of the number of times I want you to push the button. Okay, so now you can actually see that number on the inside. So you can imagine, I put a button right there, button. And then you see that this number, and it decreases by one. So if I give you a button, such a machine that's initialized with 77, then you push the button once. Now it says 76. You push the button again. Now it says 75. You push the button again. Now it says 74. You can actually see the button. You can see the number is what I mean. So that's the distinction between the two exercises. So now, what that one is, is now back in my secret laboratory. I now give you, the in is outside of the machine, and I give you the button machine. You can see both of them. And what you do now
is the following. Is I take both of these inputs, because on that exercise you're asking about, there's two inputs. There's in and the other thing. So I give you both of these. And now, if in is zero, that is to say, I don't want you to push the button anymore. This is when you stop. Okay, so if that's the case. And also, in here, you have to push the button once, so now we need a stylization of pushing the button. What will that look like? A finger? I'll try. You gotta push the button once. 3, 4, right? 4? Yeah, 4. That's push the button once. Okay, but not only do you push the button once, okay, you call, now you take these two outputs, you give the machine back, the button machine back. So the button machine has to be put back into the top of your machine, but now you also need to pass to it in minus one to indicate that I pushed the button once. I pushed the button once and it need be pushed. And so what I'm saying is that if I were to pass into you the button machine and the number 75, then you'd say, ah, well, 75 isn't zero, so I need to do something. So I push the button and then I return the button machine and a 74 back to the top. And I keep doing this until I get a zero. It's a finger. Any question about this one? So this is okay? Okay. And so I want to point out so that everyone knows the group dynamic. Okay, so in this group of students, which is the same in every group of students for a first programming class, for various biographical historical reasons, about a third of you have prior experience writing programs, like a lot, like you've maybe taken a class or maybe it's your hobby or something. About another third of you were passingly familiar with it before you got here, for whatever reason. And about a third of you are brand new to it. So understand the dynamic that one third of the class, this is really easy because they've already done stuff just like this before. Another third of the class is looking at this and saying, gosh, I can't believe how much difficulty I'm having with this task. And I'm looking over there and all of those students are doing just fine. Okay, but that's just the way it is, and that's part of the reason why there's no fixed due date on the homework assignments, because I really don't care if it takes you 4 weeks to finally have your aha and say, oh, okay, I get it, fine. That's fine, I don't care. But I want you all to know, especially the ones that are experiencing lots of frustration, that you will probably look back on these assignments and look back at them and say, gosh, I can't even believe how much difficulty I was having. It's obvious to me now. Okay, so I'm just trying to let you be encouraged. Everybody on their first programming language has a lot of frustration. Good. Okay. So, we've talked about two modes of iteration. What are they?
Recursion. Loops.
And loops. Iteration generally just means doing something over and over again. There's two ways to tell the machine to do this. One of them is recursion, and the other is loops. MATLAB is, most programming languages prefer one or the other by design. Like their underlying design either is biased toward recursion or it is biased toward loops. MATLAB happens to be a language that is biased toward loops, but there's other languages that are biased toward recursion. So that's that it's good and it's bad, it sort of just is what it is, but mathematics itself, like the instruction, the understanding of abstract mathematics is biased toward recursion. So there's a little bit of a impedance mismatch that, for example, the factorial definition in mathematics is recursive, yet the definition that's most natural to write in MATLAB is with a loop. So we've got, for iteration, there's two main styles. There is, just like we just said, recursion. And loops. And then, if you get really interested in computer science, then you'll start looking at the machine itself. How does the processor actually do things? The processor doesn't have either one of these. It doesn't have recursion or loops. It has something more abstract called a jump. So, but we won't worry about that. Okay, so what I'm going to do on this page is I'm going to write three functions. I'm going to try and write one here, here, and then one in the bottom, middle. And so what the purpose of this is I want to show you the two different styles, recursion and loops, and then I'm going to draw one more that's a different kind, and we're going to compare and contrast. So it'll be a different style of recursion that's intimately related to loops. So specifically, let's recall the factorial definition, that n factorial is 1 if n is 0, and it is n multiplied by n minus 1 factorial otherwise. And of course, this is only defined for the non-negative integers. So n in the naturals, and I'll write a star here. By which I mean the naturals and zero. Just in case in your brain the naturals don't include zero. Okay. So here's a recursive definition. In MATLAB. So one input n, one output m, and just like the math definition there, there'll be two clauses. So if n is equivalent to 0, then the output is assigned to 1. And otherwise, what is the output? So it'll be fact of n minus 1. So is this right?
The n times.
N times this, right? Okay, so then I'd like for us to observe once again that in this MATLAB definition, how similar looking it is to the math definition, right? The math definition has two clauses. The MATLAB recursive definition has two clauses. Okay. N times the previous factorial, N times the previous factorial. Any questions about this? So this is recursive style definition of factorial in MATLAB. So now let's do a loop style definition. Okay, so in order to do this, we're going to need a loop in the first place, right? So then, what kind of for loop will we need? So somehow we'll need for, and then what?
For I equals 1, colon, n.
Okay, for I is 1. To n. So that means that this 1 colon n, what that will do is that'll create the sequence of numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way up to n. So if n happened to be 21, then it would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the way up to 21. And what this loop body will do is we'll execute whatever is inside of the loop body once for each element of the sequence. Okay, so then what do we need to do inside the loop body?
I times n.
Okay, I times what?
N.
N?
No. Times I?
Crap. Yeah, think about it.
M equals I times n.
M is what?
I times n.
I times m. Okay, so up here in this vertical space that I happen to leave for myself, we've got to initialize it to 1, right? And then, there it is. Okay. So any question about this loop definition? Any question about it? So this is kind of how school children would calculate the factorial, right? To say that, okay, 5 factorial, well, that'd be 1 times 2 is 2, times 3 is 6, times 4 is 24, times 5 is 120. This is really similar to the school children definition. Okay, so any question about these two? Yes?
So for recursive, you need the if and else clauses?
Mm-hmm.
That's what makes it recursive?
No, what makes it recursive is the fact that was terrible, I shouldn't have done that, is that this function that we're defining fact is calling itself. Recursive means self-referential. So if we were to evaluate fact of 5, then this function in turn would need to evaluate fact of 4. So it's going to call itself. Notice that this function in particular doesn't do any function calls whatsoever. So in particular, it's not calling itself. This one is calling itself. Similarly, in the math definition, this factorial, for example, 10 factorial is defined as 10 times 9 factorial. So the fact that this one, this factorial, is defined in terms of previous factorials is what makes this recursive. Sort of like the bad joke. If you look up
the definition in the dictionary of recursive, it says C recursive. The definition refers to itself. I guarantee if I was writing a dictionary that I would do that. And then be fired from the...
If you Google recursion, it'll say, did you mean recursion? Right, right under the search bar.
I like it. Okay, so any question, other questions about these two? Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to make another recursive definition, but it is really actually very, very similar to the loop definition. Okay? And it's a little bit taller. So this kind of recursion we're going to call a tail recursion. And for now, we'll just have to leave it as a matter of intrigue and mystery. Why am I calling it tail recursion? We'll get to that in a minute. So now this is inside of a, so by this I mean this a file, and by this I mean a file. So here I'm drawing a file. So, and in particular, this one I'm calling fact.m, and this one fact.m. So they're both this. So you couldn't have both of these, right? One or the other. And I'm going to call this one fact.m also. Okay. So function M is fact of n. So all of these functions that we're writing on this page all have the same signature. Okay, and what this one is going to do, this one is going to do something in here. And I'm going to leave that for the moment. I'm going to come back to this. I'm going to write some stuff in here, but right now I'm going to make a new function inside that's also inside of this same file. So immediately after this function that I'm not yet defining, I'm making another one. Now, because this occurs in a file named fact.m, this function will be the only one that's visible to the outside world. But inside of this file, this one I'm writing is going to be visible to that one. Okay. So we're going to say that this is M is, I'll call this fact and then underscore TR. Why do you think I'm going to call it TR? For tail recursive. And I'm going to give it the value k, and also the value n. So this function now has two arguments. This function has two arguments. So now it's going to start looking like this one. It's going to start looking like this one. Except now it will look as follows. So if n is equivalent to 0, if n is equivalent to 0, then the output is k. And otherwise, the output is fact TR. So the fact that now I'm about to call fact TR here means that this function that I'm writing is recursive. Okay, this function that I'm writing is recursive. And what's going to go in the first position here now is k multiplied, in MATLAB is an asterisk, multiplied by n, and n minus 1. End. So now let's think about this for a moment. So there's really two things that are occurring in this loop. There's two things that occur. Is that we perform a multiplication. We perform a multiplication, and then we move to the next element in the sequence. Right? So we make I times M and store that new value, and then we move I to the next value. And if we run out of values, that's when we stop. So that's what happens in this loop. Now, what I want you to observe here is that this is also doing two things. We perform a multiplication, and we move to the next value. Perform a multiplication and move to the next value. So the only thing that we need to do in this function that I've left blank is the part of this function that the loop is not doing. So this function does two things. It does a loop part and then something else. What's the something else? It initializes the first value of m. So all that this function needs to do is the following. Is it says the output will be fact tr. And then what is the initial value for the loop? 1. And then n. So now, to make the analogy clear, this line is exactly this. And this line, these lines, are exactly this. Okay. So it's just yet another style of recursion. But now this one has a different name, and I'm pointing it out specifically. I'm pointing it out specifically because it's important. Now we need to explain, well, why should it be called a tail recursive? And notably, this one is recursive, but not tail recursive, right? In the same fashion that this is a red pen. This is a red pen. And this is a pen, but not a red one, right? So this is a recursive function, and this is a recursive function. This is a tail recursive function, but this one is not. So now I need to explain to you what the adjective tail means in the context of recursive. Okay. So now on the next page, what I'm going to do in two columns is we're going to look at the execution of fact, of this fact, the recursive fact,
for, say, the input of 4, and we're going to look at the execution of the tail recursive fact for the input of 4. Okay. Okay, so if we were at the command line, the MATLAB command line, and we typed fact of 4, if we typed that, and the fact file that we had was this one, then let's see. So there's how many variables in this one? 2, right? So then MATLAB in the first place would say, because we didn't give a left-hand side to this, where is MATLAB going to store this value?
ANS.
In ANS. So what MATLAB does is it makes a little table here. ANS. And it's going to store the output of that function. Okay, now to do this, it's going to first call fact of 4. And fact has 2 slots, M and N. And the current value of N is what?
4.
And if you look at the code here, it's going to say, okay, so is N equivalent to 0? No, it's 4. So this branch is not going to be executed, rather this one is. So in order to update the value of M, the first thing that needs to occur is we need to evaluate fact of 3. So this call is a result of calling fact of 4. Now we're going to make another call. Fact of 3, and MATLAB's going to analyze the source code and say, oh, there's 2 slots. M and N. The current value of M is unknown. What is the current value of N?
3.
And then MATLAB's going to look at this and say, is 3 equivalent to 0? No, so it's not going to execute that branch. It's going to execute that branch. But in order to execute that branch, we have to evaluate what?
Fact of
2. And so MATLAB will make a new workspace with 2 slots, M and N. The present value of M is unknown, but the present value of N is what?
2.
2. It won't execute this branch, it'll execute that one. And in order to do that, we need to evaluate fact of 1. So MATLAB will establish a new workspace with 2 slots. M and N, the current value of M is unknown. The current value of N is what?
1.
MATLAB will ask, is 1 equivalent to 0?
No.
It isn't. So in order to evaluate the second clause, we'll need to evaluate fact of 0. Then we'll have M and N. The current value of M is unknown, but N is known to be what?
0.
So now notably, now we're in this clause, and MATLAB will ask, is 0 equivalent to 0?
Yes.
It is. So this is the first place where in any of these invocations that are all going on currently, this is the first time that we can make a value of M. Okay, so then M finally gets a value. What is its value?
One.
Okay, then this output is passed back to the previous caller. And you take this output, M, and you're going to multiply it with that N. So 1 times 1, and then this is going to be stored in this value as N, as 1. Let's make that red. 1. So now this workspace is destroyed. It's gone. And now we have this value of M. So this value of M will be returned to its caller and multiplied by that N. So 1 times 2 is 2, and then that will be stored in this value of M, 2. Now this workspace is destroyed. This value of M will be returned to its caller. And we'll take that value of N and multiply it by this value of M and get what here?
6.
Then we'll take this value and return to its caller, multiply that value of M and that value of N to right here. The product is stored here. And then this is the call that was on the command line. So now that value of M is simply returned and stored here. And then because we didn't put a semicolon, MATLAB now dutifully prints out ANS equal to 24. It's a nice coordinated procedure, right? So what I'd like for you to observe is that on this particular invocation, things were happening going down and up. And essentially, most of the action, in fact, all of the arithmetic, was occurring when we were coming back up. No arithmetic was occurring when we were going down. Well, okay, with the exception of subtracting 1 from the N. So we were decrementing N. But all of the multiplication, anyway, was happening when we were coming back up. Okay. So now let's observe what happens if instead of the non-tail recursive version, we try and figure out what does the tail recursive one do. So tail recursive. Fact. And if again, we call fact a 4. And now we're using this definition. So because we didn't give a left-hand side, MATLAB's going to compute fact of 4, however it does it, and where's it going to store it? In ANS. So MATLAB makes a little table here, a little slot, and says, okay, whatever factor 4 does, I'm going to put it in ANS. And in order to figure that out, so now I'm going to make the call factor 4. And I can see that factor 4, this, has two inputs, or two values, M and N. Okay, so M and N. And now here's where things get different. Because in contrast to the non-tail recursive version, this one will now not call fact. What's it going to call? Fact TR. So this will be, the value of N is known to be 4. M is what needs to be computed. So what this does is it calls fact TR. (Clears throat)
and it's going to call it with what? 1 and 4. Okay, so now, how many symbols are in the table that FACTR uses to compute, and what are they?
Three.
There's three, right? There's M, K, and N. So which ones are known, and what are the values? K is 1, N is 4, and M?
We don't know.
Is unknown. Okay. So what this will do is it'll come here and say, okay, my N is 4, so is 4 equivalent to 0?
No.
It is not. So that branch will not be executed, that branch will be executed. So what we're going to do here is to do this. What is going to end up being called? Fact TR of what?
One.
Not one. Is it one? No.
No. One times four.
One times four.
Three.
And three. So this will be now 4, 3. Okay, so that gets called. So FACTR has been called again, which means we need to make a new table with three slots, M, N, and K. Let's do it in the same order as the one above it. M. K and N. So in this invocation of FACTR, which ones are known and what are their values?
N is 3.
N is 3.
K is
4. And
M is unknown.
M is unknown. So now we're going to execute this again, and I'm going to ask myself, is 3 equivalent to 0?
No.
It is not. So do you see that we'll keep recursing? So now I'll do this part fast. So now what is the invocation of FACTR? So FACTR what?
12, 2.
12, 2. M, K, N, 12. 2, and then we'll invoke FACTR. What's the new invocation now?
24, 1.
M, K, N. 24, 1. And then I'll ask myself, well, is 1 equivalent to 0?
No.
It is not. So now I'll call fact TR. Fact TR. And then what are the arguments now?
24, 0.
24 and 0. M, K, N, 24, 0. And now here's where the action changes. Okay, what do I mean by that?
Since N is equal to 0.
Yes.
M is equal to K, so N is 24. And
yes. So now what happens is that we get into this clause and we say, oh, well, M is whatever the first argument is. So this now gets copied here. And this value is returned to the caller. And what I'd like for you to observe is that what is the caller going to do with it? Just keep returning it over and over and over and again, all the way to the top. So this goes here, unchanged, 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 unchanged. So, could someone describe what is concerning these two, tracking the state of the machine all the way down? How are these two significantly different?
The calculation that it does all the calculations on the when it's going down.
Uh-huh.
After it once it reaches zero, it's all it does to get back to the actual output.
Mm-hmm.
Copy,
copy, copy, copy, copy, all the way back up. So this one's doing a little bit of work going down and a little bit of work coming back up. So going down, it's decrementing in, and coming back up, it's performing the multiplication. Whereas this one is doing both operations going down. It's decrementing and multiplying going down. And then when it hits the bottom, all that's necessary is to return. Return, 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 return. Okay, so now, the distinction is, and the reason why these are related, is that when you are writing something explicitly as a loop, for example, in this definition, this is a loop. This variable m in the loop definition is referred to as the accumulator. So this is the accumulator. It is the slot, the variable, that's accumulating the computation. So in particular, because factorial is a product definition, it's being updated with a product, with a multiply. In the Gauss function, instead of the arithmetic operation being product, what's the arithmetic operation in the Gauss function?
Sum.
Okay. So you can accumulate with sum, you can accumulate with product, you can accumulate with whatever other kind of thing you can imagine. So in the Pop Goes the Weasel exercise, in that one, you're accumulating cranks. So in the hidden in the exercise where the number of cranks is hidden, okay, if I hide a 73 in there and you can't see it, you crank it once. Inside the machine, now there's a 72. Okay, so the machine is the one that's formally doing the accumulation for you. Okay. So here's the accumulator. Notably, there in this loop, there's two things at play. There's the accumulator and the actual accumulation, where the computation that's occurring and the place where it's being stored. So this is different. This is different because nothing is accumulating the value, in a sense. The accumulation is implicitly happening inside of this call stack. So the tail recursive version, what it does is it says, okay, I'm going to explicitly define an accumulator, and what are we calling it? K. K is what is accumulating the value, right? It starts out as 1, and then 4, and then 12, and then 24, and then 24, and now we detect accumulation has finished. So now copy the accumulator to the output value and return it. So any question about these three styles? This is all okay? Okay. Admittedly, this is pretty dry.
Is one faster than the other?
That depends entirely on the programming language in question. In MATLAB, this one will be fastest, this one second fastest, this one slowest. In other programming languages, the order will be different. And in even other programming languages, this doesn't even exist. There are not actually loops. For example, my most favorite and tender spot in my heart for programming languages for one called Scheme, and it does not have loops whatsoever. If you want to make a loop, effectively like a loop that could execute, for example, billions and billions of iterations, you must make it tail recursive. And the reason why that will work is that notably, when you're performing this call stack, the machine has to keep track of this one and this one and this one and this one and this one. And then after it finishes with the bottom one and returns, then it destroys this one, and then this one returns and it destroys that one, and then this one returns and it destroys that one. So what happens is that on an execution like this, you can only recurse a few thousand times. Otherwise, the machine will run out of memory. It just won't work any further. But notably, notice these particular tables. We got to here and we noticed that we're done now. So it's time to start returning. Did we end up using K and N?
No.
No. What about here?
No.
No. What about here?
No.
No. So do you observe that once we did our thing with K and N, and then made a new stack frame, which is what these are technically called, we no longer use these. What that means, and what actually happens in programming languages that can detect that, is they don't even keep these. These are destroyed as they're made. So a tail recurse, if the programming language detects that it's in this situation, it doesn't store these at all. It just destroys them as soon as it's done with them. So now, why is it called tail recursion? The distinction is that notice on the left that there are some operations that occur on the way back up. So operations, multiplications are occurring on the way back up. But for this one, the only thing that's occurring on the way back up is a copy. No operations whatsoever. So the distinction is that this call is said to be in tail position. So this recursive call is in tail position. And the reason why it's in tail position is that this value is computed and nothing at all is done with it except copying it to the output and returning it to the caller. Here, we compute something, fact of n minus 1, and then after we've computed it, then we perform a multiplication, and then we return it to the caller. So this recursive call is not in tail position. So this is not tail position. Okay. So any question about this? Yes?
When MATLAB, if you actually use the factorial function, does MATLAB just have a list of values stored, or does it do one of these?
I don't know off the top of my head. I imagine it does one of these. Except it'll do something even more efficient than this. Because MATLAB as a language itself is not very efficient. What MATLAB actually is that it's designed to do to call libraries which are efficient. And so back in the day when people wanted to, you know, do numerical computations, it was all done in a language called Fortran, essentially, more or less. And all that MATLAB is, it's a very, when it was initially made, it was a very thin wrapper on top of Fortran. So what I imagine MATLAB does to compute the factorial function is it takes your input and immediately passes it to a Fortran routine. Hand off. Okay, so in the few minutes that we have left, let's consider a new exercise. So we considered this on the first day, but I want to remind you of it because now it's going to be an exercise. And that is the following. So what do I want to say? I guess M and N. Let M and N be naturals. So let M and N be naturals. Then there exists unique Q and R in the naturals and possibly zero, such that the following things are true. M is Q multiplied by N plus R, and 0 is less or equal to R is less than N. So what is the name for this?
Quotient
and remainder. This is division. Okay? Which is to say, for example, I could say, here's a stack of 23 M&Ms. And I want you to take this stack of 23 M&Ms and I want you to break it into groups of size 4. Well, how many groups of size 4 could you make with 23 M&Ms?
5.
You could make 5 groups. You could make 5 groups. And then what would remain?
3.
And you can make no more groups. So notably, if there were 23 M&Ms and I said make groups of size 4, if you made 4 groups, how much would remain? 7, right? Because 4 times 4 is 16, you would have taken away 16, there'd still be 7. So that 7, that's not what I'm talking about. Why is 7 not legitimate? Because we could make another group, right? So you got to think about this like a kindergartner and say, well, If I can eat all the groups of 4 that I make, and there's still 7, then I'm going to make another group of 4, right? Or if you don't like that, you can think of it as stacks of $1,000, right? What if there's $23,000 on the table, and I say you can take as many groups of 4,000 as you want, and they're all stacks of 1,000? Would you leave 7,000 on the table?
No.
No, right? You can take another one, right? Another group of 4. Same deal. So the way we're going to do this is at least the first time we're going to do this is going to be just like a kindergartner would do it. There'd be 23 M&Ms, and then you could take away 4. Then you'd have 19. And then you'd ask, could I still take away 4?
Yes.
Yeah, then you take away 4, then you have 15. Can I still take away 4? Yes, you take away 4, then you have 11. Can I still take away 4? Yeah, then you take away 4 and you have 7. And can I still take away 4?
Yes,
so you take away 4 and you have 3. And then can you still take away 4?
No.
So now you count the number of groups that you were able to take away. What is that one called?
The remainder.
The number of groups you can take away, what remains is called the remainder. So the 3 are the remainder. Maybe. What is the number of groups that you can take away? What's it called?
Quotient.
The quotient. So quotient is the number of groups you can take. Remainder is what remains when you've done that. Okay, so we're going to do it exactly like that with loops and recursion and tail recursion. It's going to be so enjoyable. So any questions before that's it? Okay, so have a nice Tuesday.